Welcome back to ELTR 1114, Digital Fundamentals at Kankakee Community College. This is week 17, the last week of lecture, next week, final exams. And this is the last unit we're covering on the 555 timer chip. Now, the 555 timer basically outputs square wave clock signals. So we should look at some terminology on that stuff first. Let's look at some basic concepts, and I'll get my ugly mug out of the way here so we can do that. First of all, period. This is a repeating waveform, and when I go from identical parts of one repetition to another, that distance is called the period. And the reason it's labeled T is because it's measured in time, typically in seconds. And now the frequency is how many periods occur in a second. Obviously, high frequency is many repetitions in a second. Low frequency is fewer frequencies in a second. And period and frequency are the inverse of one another. If I know the period, 1 divided by the period tells me how many cycles per second. Or if I know how many cycles per second, 1 divided by cycles per second tells me the time of the period. Now, notice that these two do not have, they're not equal. The on time and the off time are not equal. Obviously, this is where I start. This is where I repeat and start again. So there's my period. We can call this one T1 or T high or T on. This one can be called T2 or T low or T off. Now, duty cycle is referring to what percentage of the whole time is the thing on or high. So to calculate that, I take the on time, the high time, and I divide it by the whole time, and I can express that as a percent. Right here, I've got three different waveforms. They all have exactly the same frequency. See how they all line up, and then they all repeat on the same line? So these all have the same frequency, but different duty cycles. This one looks half and half, and it is. That's a 50% duty cycle. It's on half the time. This one's only on 20% of the time, 20% duty cycle. This one is high 80% of the time, 80% duty cycle. So keep those terms in mind as we go forward. Now let's take a quick peek at the 555 timer chip. Essentially, inside of that little integrated circuit, we have a voltage divider that goes all the way from VCC to ground. I have three identical resistors in there. From this point to ground, I have 2/3 of the total voltage. From this point to ground, I have 1/3 of the total voltage. And here's an interesting point. 5K ohm, 5K ohm, 5K ohm. Can you see why it's called the 555 timer chip? Because the three resistors in the voltage divider circuit inside are all 5K ohm resistors. There are also two comparators in here. Comparator 1 attached to pin 2, comparator 2 attached to pin 6. Now, here's how these comparators work. When the voltages on both sides are equal, it triggers the comparative to send an output to the flip-flop. And so let's look at pin 2 first. That is at the 1/3 VCC point. This side of the comparator knows what that is. When this external voltage gets down to the 1/3 VCC, 1/3 total voltage, it activates the comparator to trigger the flip-flop to flip its output state from low to high, which goes out right here. That's the output, flips from low to high. Over here on pin 6, this knows what 2/3 of VCC is. When this external voltage comes up to 2/3 of the total voltage, that triggers this comparator to hit the flip-flop and flop it back from high to low. And then we have an output stage down here, and this is for discharging external capacitors and so forth. So that's how this guy is put together. We get into a lot of detail on that, but at this point, it's not that important to go any deeper. Now, we use this 555 to create different kinds of multivibrators. First of all, the 555 has probably been one of the most popular and most well-used in hobby electronics of any IC out there. It's been around for over 30 years, still being used for all kinds of fun projects. Inside of there are digital and analog components. It's sometimes called the IC time machine. It can be used for bounce-free switches, frequency dividers, pulse generators, flasher circuits, sound effects devices, all kinds of things. So many hobby applications, especially for this. Depending on how we connect external components determines what sort of multivibrator it's going to be. We have the capability of turning the 555 into a bistable multivibrator, a monostable, otherwise known as a one-shot, or an astable, otherwise known as a free-running clock or an oscillator. Now, let's look first at the bistable mode. Bistable means I have two stable modes. I have a stable high load and I have a stable low load, different than my monostable. So what I've got here is set reset, basically. Inside of there is that flip-flop, and effectively a bistable multivibrator is a flip-flop. When I flip it to high, it's stable high. When I flip it to low, it's stable low. As a bistable, it's triggered to activate on a falling clock edge, falling edge. So in this case, I give it a falling clock edge and I'm going to flip it high. It's going to be stable there. It'll stay there until I give it another falling clock edge, and then it flops to a stable low. And every time I give it a clock pulse, it's going to flip or flop in the other direction and stay stable wherever it is. That is bistable flip-flop multivibrator operation. Next, let's look at one-shot operation. The one-shot, otherwise known as the monostable. Monostable means one stable state. Its stable state is low. It has a temporary state that is triggered again by a falling clock edge. Depending on the size of the components you put on this thing, that determines, by RC time constants, that determines the width of this monostable pulse. And once you build it, whenever you trigger it, it's going to be the same length of pulse every time you trigger it. This trigger can be anything. It can be a push button. You decide you want to push it and get like a tone burst on a foghorn or something for 2 seconds. Or you could have it like on a limit switch. And every time a limit switch is hit, it puts a clock pulse and gives you an output like a light flashes for 10 seconds or whatever. So that is the monostable mode. Now, we can calculate the width of that monostable pulse. And look familiar, RC time constant. We approximate the width of that pulse by multiplying the value of R1 times the value of C1, and then multiply times 1.1. And that gives us the width of that pulse, which will be output anytime it sees a falling edge on the clock input. Some people are a little bit lazy and don't want to do the calculations, so they do make fun things like nomographs where they lay it all out. This nomograph shows my capacitor value for C1 in microfarads. These lines show my R1 values in ohms, kilo-ohms, and mega-ohms. And wherever these things meet, I drop down. So you can see right here, if I've got a 10K resistor and a 1 microfarad capacitor, I'm going to have a pulse of a little over 10 seconds right there, or 10 milliseconds. So that kind of gives you an idea how that works. The third and final form of how we configure this 555 timer is the astable free-running clock or oscillator. This one has no input. This one, you power it up after it's built, and it's designed for a specific duty cycle, a specific period, a specific frequency, and once you power it up, it just goes. Now, here's how we get into different duty cycles. T1 is the amount of time it takes to charge the capacitor up to 2/3 of VCC. T2 is the amount of time it takes to discharge it down to 1/3 of VCC. So if I put a large resistor here, it's going to take longer to charge up. If I put a small resistor here, it's going to discharge quicker. So that's basically how you vary this thing. There is some math that goes into this. You can calculate the on time, and you can calculate the off time or the low time, or you could call this the charge and the discharge time. And when I have those two times, my high level and my low level times, I add those together, gives me the total period. Take the period, 1 divided by the period gives me the frequency. Remember, they're the inverse of one another. And also the frequency happens to equal 1.44 divided by R1 plus 2 times R2 quantity times C1. That'll also give me the frequency. And again, our duty cycle is on time divided by the hold time, or you can calculate it with resistor values here. R1 plus R2 divided by R1 plus 2 times R2. And that'll also give you the duty cycle. So that's 555 timers in a nutshell. I do have some resources that I want to give you here. The first one I want to show you is Forrest Mims Engineer's Mini Notebook on the 555 Timer IC. I've put a PDF copy of this into your module for this week. I also have a PDF of a piece of paper that summarized step-by-step operation of the 555 internally, and I've got some other handouts in there. But this is a great project chip, and this is a great project book. In fact, you've got two labs this week, and they come from this. So let's go over and take a quick peek at a little bit of Forrest Mims and Forrest Mims 555 circuits book. All kinds of stuff. It's at least 32 pages long, with all kinds of just circuits you can build, projects that you can work on in your spare time if you want to. Basic A-stable circuit, basic bistable circuit, a timer plus a relay. There's also a chip called the 556, which basically is two 555s on board. And you can use this guy for pulse width modulation. Look at this picture down here. I actually did this, something similar to this, to build an aeroponic system. Basically, what we had was driving a relay with the 555 timer chip. We had to turn on a sprayer that would spray plant roots hanging in midair. It had to spray for 10 seconds every minute of nutrient solution. So we just set this up so that I had one timer was every minute, boom, 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 it would give me a clock pulse. And then that was the A-stable multivibrator half. And then the second half was a one shot, which would give me a 10-second pulse. So that way, that 10-second pulse output to a relay, we used a solid-state relay, that triggered a pump that would spray the roots with nutrient solution. So all kinds of fun projects here. Voltage-controlled oscillators, frequency meters, a toy organ. This is one of your labs for this week. All kinds of good stuff. So if you get into playing with this, you'll see there are lots of circuits available, not only in this book, but all over the internet. So that's it for the lecture for 555 timers. I've got two labs for you this week. I'll do a couple demonstrations on those, and you'll see those just in a little bit. Bye-bye.